Today we bring to you the story of a remarkable American in Gandhi's India. Samuel Stokes, born to a life of wealth and privilege, gave it all up at the tender age of 21 to volunteer in a leper colony in a remote town in the Himalayas. Stokes went on to participate in India's freedom struggle against the British. He achieved lasting fame as the man who brought the delicious apple variety to India. Who better to tell us this fascinating story than Stokes' own granddaughter, Asha Sharma? My name is Renu Khosla, and I will be your host today for this edition of The Better Part. Stay tuned.
Welcome to The Better Part, a program by and for seniors, and devoted to exploring the many facets of those better years of our lives. The name of our program is inspired by a quotation from Robert Browning. Grow old along with me, the best is yet to be, the last of life for which the first was made. Now, sit back and enjoy a program made especially to provide seniors with useful information, plus some lighter moments to brighten your day.
Asha Sharma has written the biography of her grandfather entitled An American in Gandhi's India. Asha is with us in the studio today to tell us the life story of her American grandfather, Samuel Stokes. Hello and welcome to our studio, Asha.
Thank you very much, Renu. I'm happy to be here.
Well, the first chapter of your book entitled Journey of No Return really touched me. Can you tell our viewers about that fateful day when Samuel Stokes took off for India?
My grandfather left for India from Philadelphia on January 4th, 1904 to work in a leper home in Sabatu in the Shimla Hills. His family was all there to see him off. His father, Samuel Stokes Sr., his mother, Florence Spencer Stokes, his sister Anna, 19, younger sister Florence, 14, and brother Spencer. Sam, of course, was very excited about his journey, but the family felt differently. I think I'll read a few lines from the book to describe the scene. It was a cold and dreary day, ominous of an uncertain future, and Florence Stokes found herself shivering in a warm fur coat. When the steamer disappeared from sight and the family turned to go home without Sam, Samuel Stokes Sr. put his arms around his heartbroken wife. "Don't worry too much, dear," he comforted her. "We had to let him go. He would have never settled down to anything else till he had tried this out. But he will be back in a year or two." But as it happened, Renu, it was not a year or two. He never did really return home. And he did return home for a short periods. And so they did lose him for life, in a way.
So it was a journey of no return.
Yes. How Sam set off on this journey was a coincidence. In the summer of 1903, he met a physician, Dr. Carlton, who used to work in a leper home in India and who was from Philadelphia, and who was visiting home to meet his family as well as to raise money for the leper home and to recruit volunteers. Sam heard him talk about the condition of the lepers and the dire need of volunteers. And he was so touched by the story that he decided to go with him. And he told his parents, "Well, I'm going to India and I'm going to work in this leper home." And a few months later, he was on his way.
It seems inconceivable that a single young man born to wealth and privilege would travel 6,000 miles to a place with no basic conveniences like electricity, potable water, drinking water. Were there any family issues that prompted him to take a decision like that?
He belonged to a distinguished family of Philadelphia and of Quaker descent. The progenitor of the family, Thomas Stokes, had come to Philadelphia in 1670. He was a contemporary of William Penn. His father himself was a pioneer of elevators, and he was the founder proprietor of Stokes and Parrish Machine Company. So they were very well off. But despite all this, I don't think that Sam I like to call him Sam when he's young. I don't think that Sam was really concerned about physical comforts. They really didn't matter to him very much. He was very grounded. The second part of your question, were there any family issues? No, none whatsoever, I think. They were a close-knit family. They cared for each other. But his parents were definitely disappointed over his decision. His father particularly, I think, felt it deeply. While his mother appreciated his work in social work, she was also very concerned because he was going to work among lepers. Now, this was a very dangerous work. Leprosy, as we know, was known to be very contagious, and there was no cure for it at that time. So she really didn't want him to go. But they knew their son, and they also knew that once he had made up his mind, nothing would, make him change his decision. So what is very interesting is that his father made sure that Sam would have sufficient money to live on while he was in India. So he made him arranged to give him $500 a year in quarterly installments for a period of 5 years. He thought after 5 years he will certainly come home, but as I just mentioned, he did not return home.
That is a big amount 100 years ago,
yes,
and especially in India. Yeah. What were his experiences like during his early years in India?
During these early years, he worked in the leper home. He worked in a plague-stricken village. He worked in an earthquake, in Kangra, in the major earthquake in Kangra. And he also worked in smallpox camps. He opened schools in the interior of Himachal. He did missionary work, and he also started a Franciscan order, calling it the Brotherhood of Imitation of Jesus, which became very well known in England as well as in India. Mm-hmm. During all this time, he also made an effort to come closer to Indians, and he wanted to be like them. But his anxiety during all this time was that no matter what he did, he could not really get close to Indians. They would respect him, they treated him very well, but they did not treat him as one of themselves.
Am I right in thinking Samuel Stokes married an Indian girl?
Oh yes, he married an Indian girl, very much an Indian girl. My grandmother, Agnes, she was from Shimla Hills. In fact, she lived in the same place where my grandfather did much of his work during the first few years when he was there. I don't think that he could have really met any charming young British girl socially. The reason for his marrying an Indian girl was that he thought by marrying an Indian, he would get closer to the Indian community and he will be able to identify with them. So that was the reason he decided to marry my grandmother. And the second reason why he chose to marry an Indian girl was that he wanted to prove that he was not racist in his attitude. We have to remember that he was a Quaker, really believed in equality of all people. And to him, it all was very despicable. And he said, he didn't believe in racism. And he said, when I marry an Indian girl, it'll be proof that I am really beyond being a racist. As far as education of my grandmother was concerned, yes, she was not very well educated in the normal terms. She had just studied, I think, up to the fourth standard, and no English at that time because they were studying only Hindi and Urdu. But she was an intelligent girl, and after the marriage, my grandfather took great pains to educate her. When when the family came to know that he was going to get married to an Indian girl, his mother's first reaction was that I must go to India. At first, she didn't want to talk about it to her family, but when she did, her daughters and her son encouraged her to go because they knew that this was the best time for her to spend, a long enough time with her son. Once you got married, he'll get busy with other things. But it was quite a journey, all the way from ship first to Bombay and then by train to Delhi and then by train to Kalka and Shimla. And then from Shimla to the village where Stokes worked and where he married, that is Kotgarh, that is about 60 miles. That 60 miles had to be done either on foot, or you had to ride a bicycle, or you had to sit on a rickshaw, or you had to be carried on a palanquin. And my grandmother, though at first she was apprehensive about the marriage, but by the time she left Quaker, she was very comfortable with the thought that her son was going to marry Agnes. She liked her. What is very interesting, what I find, Renu, is that my grandmother at that time didn't speak any English. So my grandfather was the one who, you know, who used to translate, and so between, you know, the whatever his mother and his fiancée were wanted to communicate to each other, he was. Now, after his marriage, he took his wife and his infant son to Philadelphia. They were here for 18 months. And she met all members of the family. And their second son, Pritham, was born in Philadelphia, in the same house and in the same room where Sam himself was born 32 years earlier.
Tell our viewers something about your grandfather's family life.
It was a very interesting life because it was very, I think it was very different to what one would have expected from, you know, I mean, the way his background was and the way he married. Basically, his lifestyle was very, very simple. And he lived like all the other villagers, following all their customs. You know, like the simple things, like in the village there, even today, you don't take your shoes inside the house. You open them outside. You don't sit on chairs and tables and eat your food. You sit, go to the kitchen and sit on the floor and eat your food. And that's what he did. There was no crockery and cutlery in his house. They ate from brass utensils. And even if Europeans came to his house, they had to do the same. He didn't make any special concessions for anyone. So this is very interesting. Also, Renu, he brought up his children very simply. He felt that because if I have the money and I have this big house, it doesn't mean that we lead a special life. He wanted his kids to be like the other kids. So the children wore the clothes that the village children wore. You know, rough cottons and nothing fancy. And my mother once told me that when she was in her teens, she wanted to wear some jewelry when they were going to a fair. You know how the village girls used to dress up and go to the fairs? So her father said, no, you can't wear jewelry. Because if you wear jewelry and the other girls see you, how will they feel? They can't afford to buy the jewelry that I can afford. He said, I can dress you up from top to toe in gold, but I don't want to do it. So that was the kind of life person he was. I think on the whole, his family life there was very much like the life of his Quaker ancestors who lived in Moorestown, simple and wholesome, a life of simple joys and service.
Your book has two fascinating chapters on Begar. Tell our viewers what Begar means.
The word begar means forced labor. It's or impressed labor. It's not bonded labor, but it's not slavery, but it is forced labor. At that time, as I just mentioned, there were no motorable roads in the Shimla Hills, and if you had to carry something, either people had to carry them or loads had to be carried on mules. So, but the British officials had to travel in the interior. And they needed help for carting their luggage. So they devised a method by which they gave certain concessions, revenue concessions to villagers, in exchange for which the villagers performed certain tasks. And this was begar. So they had to give begar to the administration as and when it was required. The work could be anything, like carrying loads, or loads of, boxes or whatever, and even carrying water from the streams or collecting firewood. No.
All on their backs in the hills, right?
All on the backs in the hills. And then the villagers were either not paid for it or they were paid very little. When Stokes settled there, he said, this must go. This, you can't have a system like this. So he went to the British administrators, he requested them to do away with this practice. Nobody listened to him. He wrote in the newspapers, nobody listened to him. And then he decided to get the people together. he got them together, and then they had a protest, something like a non-cooperation, a satyagraha. And that is what did, because, you know, then it was all in the papers everywhere, and that is the time when Mahatma Gandhi noticed the work that he was doing there. And also this is the time when Mahatma Gandhi wrote about Stokes in Young India, in his newspaper Young India. I'll just read a few lines what he wrote.
Sure.
Mr. Stokes is devoting his all to the eradication of the evil of beggar. No Indian is giving such a battle to the government as Mr. Stokes. He has become the veritable guide, philosopher and friend of the hillmen. Now, and beggar was finally abolished in the hills due to Stokes, which was really something. And the people remember this even today.
Samuel also became involved in Gandhi's struggle to achieve freedom for India. Wasn't that an unusual thing for Samuel to do, being an American?
It was a very unusual thing, of course, but I think the way he was, he would have joined the freedom struggle at one point or another. Soon after the World War, when the British passed a bill called the Rowlatt Bill, which curbed the basic freedom of Indians. When they passed this bill, Stokes was very upset about it, and he condemned this bill. And then a few months later, I think that was on April 13th, 1919, when a big massacre occurred in Jallianwala Bagh in Amritsar. I think everybody knows about
that's
that.
That's in Punjab, yes.
In Punjab. And when an unarmed crowd of, you know, a peaceful crowd of 1,500 were fired upon, and hundreds of people died. And that is the time that Stokes decided that, you know, he was going to fight for India's independence, and the British must go from India.
And because he was involved in India's struggle for freedom, I understand Samuel was jailed for 6 months. What was it like?
Well, he was arrested in 1921. In fact, the date was December 3rd, 1921, near Lahore. And the charges were sedition and spreading disaffection among His Majesty's subjects. That he was put in a separate cell, which was reserved for Europeans. So there used to be a cell for Europeans and a cell for Indians.
The European cells were more comfortable, I guess.
More comfortable, better food.
Better food.
And but the downside was that despite all this, sometimes he had the company of ordinary felons. You see, because he was the only political prisoner, you didn't expect anybody else like him to be there. He wrote the first draft of his philosophical book, Satyakama. Now, this book, Satyakama, is a synthesis of Hinduism and Christianity. So this draft was written there. How did his folks back home react to his arrest? I think I'm just going to read to you a paragraph from here just to tell you what this was. His mother hesitated to talk about his arrest. A political arrest was so unheard of in America that she feared it would be misunderstood. But when the news appeared in the Philadelphia Ledger, the New York Times, and the Nation, several people talked to her about it, and to her amazement, they seemed to understand it intelligently. She now found many of them congratulating her on her son's arrest, and courage and perseverance of an ideal. "Oh, how proud I would be if he were my son," said one friend. "Bully for Sam Stokes," said another. "If more of us went to jail for what we believe, the world would soon be a better place."
Samuel gave up Western-style clothes and wore only khadi. Why did he do this, and can you explain what khadi is?
As I had mentioned earlier, he used to generally wear Indian clothes. But once he joined the independence movement, he wore only Indian clothes and only clothes made of khadi. Khadi is hand-woven cloth. Country was being drained of a lot of money, and so Gandhi thought this was a good way, you know, for us to get in the self-sufficient, and also it would also instill a kind of a discipline among people if they started wearing khadi. So Gandhi was very, very, very earnest about khadi. not only did he want people to wear khadi, he also wanted people, everyone, to burn all their Western clothes. He said only if they burnt their Western clothes will they take to wearing khadi. While a lot of Indians didn't agree with him, but Stokes supported him fully. And he did burn all his Western clothes.
So his family also burnt all their Western clothes? The children and wife?
They had a big fire up in Quaker in Harmony Hall. His son Prem was then 10 years old. He's the one who lit the bonfire. But then what is very interesting is when he wrote to his mother describing all this, he wrote to her, he said, "We burnt all our Western clothes except for the children's sweaters you knitted for them for Christmas. They did not come from America, they came from Loveland." And once when he was wearing a coat with a patch on it, and somebody asked him, you know, "Why are you wearing a coat with a patch?" And he said, "Well, my wife can only spin a limited amount of yarn and I cannot keep changing my clothes."
Oh, what drew Gandhi to your grandfather?
But I think it was my grandfather's personality which impressed Gandhi. My grandfather was very honest and very committed. And once he made up his mind to do something, he did it. You know, there was no way that he could be prevented from going ahead with what he believed in. And I think Gandhi understood and valued such qualities. But perhaps Gandhi was most impressed by my grandfather's sincerity in identifying with the Indian people, because he knew that Stokes was all for Indians, and so Gandhi wrote about it again and again in his newspapers and in his letters.
Samuel Stokes achieved lasting fame in India for reasons other than his social work and involvement with India's freedom. People in Shimla still remember him as Johnny Appleseed. Why is that so?
It is true that Stokes is mostly remembered today for the American delicious apples which he introduced in the Shimla Hills, way back in, starting from 1916, I should say. The apple story is truly, truly remarkable, and I will just tell you about it briefly. Himachal Pradesh was a very, very, very poor region, as I had mentioned earlier. The people had very small land holdings, and they would grow potatoes and maize, and they just didn't have enough to eat, you know, no money to buy clothes. And like sugar and oil was something they could have just once in a month or something like this, or once in a few months. So they were really poor. And when my grandfather settled there, he thought he must do something to improve the lot of the people. In fact, that became his mission. And he kept thinking about it. And when he went to Philadelphia in 1914, he saw how prosperous the apple growers in the area were, because, you know, there was a lot of scientific cultivation of fruits in those days. There was a lot of innovations going on. And he thought, well, if these people can do so well, why can't our people there do well in India? So when he went back to India, he took several saplings of apples of different varieties. And once he went back, he experimented. He imported more apple varieties from Europe. And he experimented with several varieties to find out which would be most suitable for Shimla Hills. And finally, he determined that it was the American Red Delicious. So that is what, you know, he introduced the Red Delicious. Then he went, once he had determined this, he went about propagating the apples in a big way. He planted orchards on his own land and encouraged his neighbors to do the same. He would give them free saplings and go to their homes and plant it for them. The next day he would go there and they would have removed it and thrown it, because they would tell him that apples would require 6 or 7 years to give fruit, and they couldn't wait for 6 or 7 years. So they'd tell him, Sabji, they used to call him Sabji, "Sabji, what are we going to eat? You know, you can afford to do this, we can't afford it." So then he would say, he told him, "I remember that I interviewed an old man when he told me," and he said, "There he was and he was telling us, put dhadi mein lagao, dhadi mein lagao. Plant them on the embankments." You see, you have the little embankments around the fields. You
say,
plant them there so that your fields are not affected. And that's what they did. And in a few years, when the apple tree started giving fruit, the people realized, you know, what a miracle this was. And soon there were apple trees all over the place, and everyone became
prosperous. Yeah.
And all 90% of the apples are from the progeny of the apples he had taken initially to the Shimla Hills, which is a great achievement, I think.
How did you manage to have His Holiness the Dalai Lama write the foreword to your book?
I think it was not a foreword for my book. I think it was a foreword for Stokes' story. His Holiness lives in the same hills as my grandfather, where my grandfather lived and died. So he's aware of all that Stokes had done for the people. He's written this foreword, and it is a very beautiful foreword. It's really very nice.
I'm certain our viewers have found the story of your American grandfather in Gandhi's India one of great interest.
Thank you very much, Renu. It's been my pleasure here to talk with you. I think I would mention one thing, that as Stokes' granddaughter and his biographer, it's heartening for me to know that this story is as much about India as it is about America. It's not about India or America, it's about both countries. For whatever my grandfather did in India and whatever he achieved in India, he was inspired by his American heritage, and he acknowledged it again and again. And I think this is how he would have also liked to be remembered. Ralph Waldo Emerson had once said, "Do not go where the path may lead. Go instead where there's no path and leave a trail." I think my grandfather did just that. He left a trail.
Thank you for joining us. We hope that you found today's program both informative and interesting. If you would like to suggest a topic or a guest for The Better Part, you can always reach us at the Cupertino Senior Center. The number there is 408-777-3150. You can learn more about us and order a copy of this program or one of the many programs that we've done by visiting our website. The website address is www.thebetterpart.com. The Better Part has many of its programs available through the Santa Clara County Library System. And The Better Part has selected programs also on YouTube. Thanks again for watching. See you next week.